Welkom. Dit is Arthur Domoslavski, Joris van Kasteren, Frank Westerman. We are going to speak about life and work of Richard Kapuscinski, famous writer and journalist from Poland. And Arthur wrote a, well, really wonderful biography about him. And the question will be, I think, this evening, when does nonfiction ends and becomes fiction? But first of all, Arthur, it must have been difficult to write this biography, like walking in a minefield. Am I right?
You stole this my description.
Yes. It's really a minefield.
You just talking about a minefield. But why was it a minefield?
At least for a few reasons. First reason is that we don't have in Poland biographies of the great figures of our culture and politics that are to some extent, I mean, critical. And usually, or if it's critical, it's like pamphlet or something like that.
Yes.
It is not common in the Polish convention of writing biographies to enter to a private life of a figure or a subject of a biography. It was also a minefield because Poland, even after 20 years, after the collapse of communism, still live with all these debates about the past. And for many people, Kapuściński's past was very controversial or even unacceptable, which is not my position, but I knew from the beginning that this was going to be a hot issue. And in the end, the issue you mentioned in the beginning, that is going to be probably one of the main of this evening, our conversation, the border between fiction and nonfiction. We have never had true discussions about it. And we, many people in Poland, especially reporters, were proud of what they called Polish school of reportage. Mm-hmm. And Kapuściński was a best example of it. So maybe we'll have a chance to talk a little bit more about it later. So this is the issues that I knew from the beginning can provoke a lot of polemics.
You're going to read a fragment. Okay. Do you have to introduce it?
Yes, this is a short fragment about these borders between fiction and nonfiction, and how I try to debate what is much more journalism and what is literature. But this is not the only fragment about this issue in the book, of course.
Okay, I think I can that you can use that microphone. No, yes, that one.
That one? Oh, wow.
It's official.
No, but it looks, I will feel like a priest in a church.
That's the idea behind it. That's the idea.
No, okay.
Yes,
so
you have to.
So for the sake of a joke, I can do it.
You have to.
I will read in Polish, so that you have a bit of amusement. Krytyka akuratności w dziele Kapuścińskiego nie podważa, tak jak ją rozumiem, literackiej wybitności jego książek, przenikliwości w rozszyfrowywaniu mechanizmów władzy, rewolucji, ludzkich postaw i zachowań. Stawia raczej pytanie o to, czy niektóre z jego utworów mogą stanowić wzór, punkt odniesienia dla dziennikarzy i dziennikarstwa, choćby dla najmniej rygorystycznie traktowanego reportażu literackiego. Także pytanie bardziej ogólne i zasadnicze. Ile wolno reporterowi? Bo zwiększenie pojemności i ubogacenie reportażu literackiego, poprawianie rzeczywistości, przekraczanie granic gatunkowych, wkraczanie na teren literatury fiction ma dla dziennikarstwa wysoką cenę. Nieprzyjemny rewers. Osłabienie wiarygodności. Na marginesie sporu o reporterską akuratność, koloryzowanie, konfabulację nie sposób postawić pytań o prawdy przekazywane przez dziennikarstwo rygorystyczne.
Na ile wiarygodne są wielkie agencje informacyjne i sieci telewizyjne powiązane z władzą ekonomiczną i pośrednio polityczną? Czy dziennikarze i komentatorzy, rygoryści nie modyfikują czasem szczegółów, nie pomijają istotnych okoliczności wydarzeń, gdy ich ukazanie uderzałoby w interesy możnych, właścicieli mediów, reklamodawców, sponsorów? Kapuściński ubolewał nieraz w ostatnich latach życia nad tym, że wielkie media uprawiają manipulacje, upraszczają, że przestały być opozycją dla systemu. Usadowiły się przy władzy, już nie kontestują, nie kwestionują zasad. To nie usprawiedliwienie dla nieścisłości reportażu literackiego. To jeszcze jedna strona debaty o dziennikarskiej wiarygodności. Jest szkoła myślenia o reportażu literackim, wedle której dziennikarz ma prawo dla dobra tekstu, dla przekazania wyższej prawdy, stworzyć, powiedzmy, fikcyjną postać z kilku postaci rzeczywistych. Tak robili niektórzy dziennikarze w czasach Polski Ludowej, by nie narażać bohaterów swoich reporterskich opowieści. Tak również uczynił na przykład Wojciech Jagielski w Nocnych Wędrowcach, książce o dzieciach wojny w Ugandzie. Ale Jagielski zastrzegł na wstępie, to fikcyjne postaci. W jednym z wywiadów nazwał swoją książkę opowiadaniem, nie reportażem. Bo jak mówił, w reportażu dla ochrony bohaterów mogę zmieniać ich imiona, ale nie tworzyć postaci. Jest absolutnie fair wobec czytelnika. Podoba mi się również, gdy mówi tak. Nie można sobie w dziennikarstwie pozwalać na zbyt wiele. Mówisz, zejdę tylko raz i na trochę ze ścieżki dziennikarstwa. Ale nieważne ile ani jak daleko, ważne, że się zeszło. Kłopot z Kapuścińskim polega na tym, że niektóre z jego dzieł mogą stanowić niepodważalny wzór dla dziennikarzy, a niektóre, niekiedy pod względem literackim, wybitniejsze, niekoniecznie. Te ostatnie są raczej książkami z półku Literatura Piękna. I to tej najwyższej. Lepiej chyba, by nie sprzedawano ich publiczności jako dzieł reporterskich. Nawet jeśli znaczącą część materiału zebrano reporterskimi metodami. A autor posługuje się także reporterskimi instrumentami narracyjnymi. To literatura fiction jest prawdą kłamstw, by posłużyć się formułą Maria Vargas Llosy. Dziennikarstwo chyba jednak nie.
Wonderful. One more thing about your book. Sorry?
It is a language that is only has consonants, right?
One more thing.
No vocals.
One more thing about your book. In your book, you argue at a certain moment that Kapuściński even reinvented himself as a fictional character. Am I right?
Yes, I think so.
How did he do that?
Well, in a different ways. On one hand, he put himself in the center of many of books he wrote, not in all of them, but so I became a tool of narrative. But also Kapuściński invented himself, contributing to the creation of a legend of himself. I think that what was behind this creation, or help to create that, was that he was coming from a country, Poland, whose language nobody understands outside, and probably he wanted to strengthen the message, to provoke interest. And I don't think it was something that we can judge in a tough way, because we all know that the world of writers is full of legends and the myths, and this is a part of literature life. So sometimes it happened that he even didn't say something, but people like to believe, like the story with Che Guevara, for example. Kapuściński never said, "I met Che Guevara." But there was one of the publishers put on the back cover of the book.
Put it on the cover.
And Kapuściński didn't correct and let people believe it happened.
That was John Lee Anderson, the famous New Yorker reporter. Yeah. He said Kapuściński could do something about that and not have that on the cover. But he didn't do it himself. So, and I read that in the book, and I was doubting about
about what?
Yeah, I mean, was it his fault or wasn't his fault? Or, of course, it was not his fault, but he could do something about it.
What would you have done?
I don't know.
You
I
met
mean,
no, Che Guevara no, but in no, Bolivia. But
the point is, with this biography, when it was published, there were headlines in the newspapers like Kapuscinski was a fraud. Mm-hmm.
But I was very, summarization. I was very upset.
Yeah, no, I can understand. Did but this was one of the most important things, that he made up this meeting.
Maybe you sorry. Okay. Maybe you should explain why you were upset.
Because I remember some headlines and titles, especially in the British press. I don't read Dutch. Like, for example, Kapuściński, a famous reporter accused of lying and spying.
Yes.
So it is completely, it is not, I know everybody, I think, who read this book can confirm that it is not how I tell the story.
Exactly the same thing that happened to him happened to you as well, in a way.
Yeah, and first, I mean, I don't think that Kapuściński was a liar. I mean, we have a lot of words and forms and shades to describe what he has done. So I prefer to say that, okay, he contributed to the legend of himself. I look at some of his books as novels, like, for example, The Emperor, which I think it's one of the
best. About Haile Selassie.
I think it's more about the court of Communist Party in Poland. In fact, it is, generally speaking, I would say this is a great political treaty about authoritarian power. Of course, there's a lot of details about Haile Selassie, about Ethiopia, about authoritarian regime there, but there's also a lot of observations that Kapuściński put into this book that he noted at the court of Communist Party in Warsaw. So I don't think this is a journalistic book, even though it's some part of it are based on the journalistic experience of Kapuściński. I think it is a fiction. It's a great treaty about absolute authoritarian power.
Yeah, but of course I read about this, and the point is, in the book when you read it, he quotes people, and you found out in your biography that. Mm-hmm. People who were quoted did not say that, or they were only part of some sort of establishment.
In fact, we even don't know if they existed.
Exactly.
They existed, but we don't know if he talked to them. I mean,
okay, but that's what you found out later.
Yeah.
Point is that you never asked Kapuściński.
Nobody asked him this question.
I wonder, when did you find out? Did you find out before? Did you ever spoke to him
about this?
Issue. Yeah,
no.
But
no.
Because you found out only later.
When he was alive, I was never thinking
you
about
never
writing
a biography.
Okay. And we had a lot of conversations, but...
But you knew about that when he was alive, or you found out... After he died,
I considered this book when I read it for the first time when I was a teenager. I thought it was about Ethiopia, but
in a way it is.
Yes, in a way. But later, when I was reading it, I have never thought it was a nonfiction, because when you read it, the courtesans of the court of Haile Selassie, they couldn't speak Baroque-like language,
no.
Poetic one, and you could find some literary allusions.
It's all about the dog.
Literary allusions to the Baroque poetry in Poland of 17th century. So everybody, okay, even if you do an interview for a story and you edit some words because, you know, people speak carelessly, so you edit it. I mean, nobody speaks... Mm. Such a long phrases, poetic phrases, full of adjectives.
No.
But did you ever ask him about that?
But a second, about asking questions. He never spoke very much. He was not a great talker.
Well, this is one of the interesting things. When I started to research for the book, I met some friends of Kapuściński, and they were convinced, come to us. We had a lot of wonderful conversations with him.
When I started to ask questions, it happened that they didn't remember anything. And they realized that it was them who were talking, and Kapuściński was only listening.
He was listening and asking questions.
I think he was a great listener.
Yes.
I think one of his greatest talents is in the capacity of listening.
Uh-huh. I mean, it was your experience as well when you talked to him?
To some extent, yes. Yeah. To some extent, yes. But I think that maybe I was a bit more privileged, so he spoke something to me.
Yeah.
But
what does that mean, something?
I mean, he shared quite sincerely his opinions about people, books, articles, events, so that probably he wouldn't share with everybody. Uh-huh. I think so.
Yeah. Frank. What does his work mean for you?
Depends on which work. I like this one.
Yes.
It's the English title is Another Day of Life. De Nederlandse Nog een Dag. It's about superficially. It's about Angola, 1975, the moment of independence. Of Angola when the Portuguese leave and the civil war starts. And when I read this for the first time, I immediately had to read it in order to, in trying to find out what is the magic. Why do I like this so much? Why I think... Maybe I never read this as a book about Angola. Mm-hmm.
Again, about Poland.
Not at all.
No,
not at all.
Not.
Not at all about Poland. Not at all about a certain guy called Richard Kapuściński looking for a glass of water in the smeltering heat of the desert. I almost ate this book. I tried to digest it, to swallow it, to... and I think that that the magic is that he stops and thinks at a certain point. Let's say the roadblock outside Luanda in the desert in Africa. There is a roadblock. He approaches the roadblock, and then he describes the roadblock. That's something that you and I, we probably should have done as well. But then he enhances about what a roadblock actually is, or what is so specific about it. What materials roadblocks usually are made of? Is it two drums and a chain between them? Who are guarding roadblocks? Are these young boys? Do they have Kalashnikovs? Are they from the party that you should adhere to as camaradas? Or should you better approach them and say irmão, the word for brother of comrade? Yeah. It can be your death sentence, he says, if you addresses yourself in the wrong way.
Mm-hmm.
This is just one paragraph.
But this is just...
Well, and then you transform, or he transforms the experience, a particular experience, to something universal.
Exactly.
It's the exception that we journalists like, the extreme. But then, what is the rule? What is the universal human general pattern behind it? And I think he is a master in translating what you see to how you could experience this. So it's not about Angola, I would argue. It's about roadblocks and at life. It's about the meaning of life.
You agree?
Yes. I think that Kapuściński was at his best in describing, I mean, picking up such wonderful details and doing reflections, general reflections around it. For example, in this book, there's a wonderful description of the crates that are on the shore before Portuguese left Angola. And through these crates,
he describes the whole Portuguese society of colonizers in Angola, because there are crates of the poor, of the middle class, of the
and
riches.
The crates, you have to add, because they want to leave Luanda for Portugal. They ask the movers to come in, and they have crates, and they build from their houses. They put all their things inside.
All belongings, the whole life they put into the crates. And
he describes the city of Wood with the belongings of the Portuguese who are going to leave, and to be able to see that next to a city of stone, a city of wood develops is, I think, it's a wild exaggeration. But he has seen it, and I have not, and you have not.
Salman Rushdie commented that there were several journalists, not very many at that time in Luanda, but there were some. But it was the only Kapuscinski who noticed this wooden city.
But the interesting thing is that it's a metaphor.
And why is that so important?
One example in Imperium, his book about
collapse of Soviet Union.
Collapse of Soviet Union. Yes, is another great example on the border with China, and then you have these smugglers going from one side to the other, and they bring back the grute. I don't know what's the English word.
Groceries.
Wheat. No. Wheat. Eat. What's it called? Wheat bugs.
Boekweit.
Boekweit, exactly.
Boekweit.
That's what the Russians
eat. The English word.
Russians eat it for breakfast.
Buckwheat. Buckwheat.
Buckwheat. I had this really nice Georgian girlfriend, buckwheat, and she had that for breakfast every day. Yeah. So you had these buckwheat smugglers, and they went to China, and they came back, and they had these really suspicious bags full of buckwheat. Mm-hmm. And then they had to come into the border police, and every day they had to open up the bags, and the border police start searching all these buckwheats to see if they were just really nice and round, it was okay. But if they had some other form, it was really suspicious. And he describes that, and in that detail, it's the whole sickness of that totalitarian regime is in that stupid detail.
Analyzing the buckwheat.
Yeah, but that's Kapuscinski, you know. And you don't want to go further into what border police said this or this Chinese smuggler said that. Who cares? It's about that detail.
But then again, back to the beginning, when does nonfiction become fiction? Or isn't that important?
Sometimes it goes immediately. No, okay, okay.
Arthur?
Okay, so I think that I would put it this way, that sometimes you can write just nonfiction, and you can do fact-checking, and it is journalism and literature at the same time, because in these examples that you described, there were roadblocks in Angola. There were the smugglers who
and then
were smuggling.
Reality
buckets.
Turns into literature. Actually,
that's
what happens.
But I think that this is the case that we quoted and we discussed, in which journalism can be a literature. But sometimes, as in the case of the emperor,
that's another story.
I think that this is another story.
Maybe you should explain. Not everyone has read The Emperor, what he did in that book.
I mean, The Emperor is a book. I mean, the narrative is done by courtesans of Haile Selassie. So they speak about the life of Haile Selassie and of the court and how it was like to be there. And through these details told by the courtesans, we can see this authoritarian or absolute power of the emperor. As I said in the beginning, Kapuscinski, it is possible, and I was told over my research, that he could have talked to maybe one, two, somewhere, the courtesans of Haile Selassie, but obviously he didn't do notes like that. They didn't speak this kind of language.
And he never made notes during conversations.
But he was doing notes afterwards.
Yeah.
So he didn't record conversations. He didn't do notes during, but in the end of the day, he was doing notes in a hotel. I think that this book, when he was writing that, in the beginning, it was published in parts at the weekly magazine Cultura of, it was 1978. It was somehow late communism in Poland. But everybody read this book as a metaphor. I mean, it had first title was A Little Bit of Ethiopia. It didn't have the title The Emperor. When it was published as book, it has the title The Emperor. But in the beginning, it was A Little Bit of Ethiopia. And everybody who read that at that time thought, wow, it's about Gerek, I mean, the first secretary of the Communist Party. And even there were some paragraphs really about the life of the Communist Party. Some people asked, why didn't he notify the readers? Not this allegory of metaphor. So imagine in Poland, 1978, there's a monopoly party rule, dictatorship, censorship. Kapuściński or whoever, or editor of the magazine, puts a note, this is allegory or metaphor. So do you think that censorship would allow to be published? Of course not. The censorship has been trapped because they couldn't censor a story about Ethiopia. What is the reason? And moreover, it's not about Mengistu, the communist dictator. It was about feudal emperors. So there was no reason to censor it. This is the whole, as I said in the beginning, Polish school of reportage. So that, for example, someone, a reporter, heard about something wrong happened in a remote city or village, traveled there and listened to the stories, but then coming back, didn't want to put in danger not in danger, maybe to harm anybody, I mean sources, people he or she talked to. So they invented these fictional characters in order to to tell the truth, or as Kapuściński sometimes put it, the truth that is truer than reality. But when he confronted with the Anglo-Saxon school of journalists, of course, I discussed with in UK when the book was published, and it was somehow hard to. It was not understood by the school.
That's what you told. That in the translation, there was some fact checker once he was translated and got published in the US.
Yeah, that was funny.
They had to.
But I wonder. I asked the question during a panel discussion. I asked the question to one of the toughest critics of Kapuściński, was Professor John Ryle, a British renowned scholar, specialist in Africa. How it was possible that Anglo-Saxon audience could consider The Emperor as a non-fiction book? Do you really believe that, could you believe that the courtesans were speaking this kind of language?
And he didn't have... And what did he answer?
He didn't have answer. I mean, I think it was one of these good questions sometimes. It happens, you can ask. But there was no answer. Because I think to some extent, because some people accuse Kapuściński of fabulating or something like that, but maybe it was the audience that created also the confusion.
I think this is an interesting point.
Why?
Well, just one simple example from the Imperium. Mm-hmm. Imperium is about Russia.
Exactly, Soviet Union.
Soviet Union.
It's about the Soviet Union, you're right. He writes about what it is when it is cold outside.
Oh yeah, with these clouds.
Really cold. It's a famous example.
Famous description.
And I was working as a correspondent in the former Soviet Union, and I also tried to write about what it is when it's Siberian cold. Mm-hmm. And so he went to Yakutsk. I think it was Yakutsk. It's one of the coldest places on Earth. And when I was reading that he quoted that girl that was on her way to school and explained to him when schools close, I think it's minus 30 or something. I forgot the details. And then she elaborates. She explains him when there is a fog and it's really cold, the fog freezes. And when you walk through it, you see the silhouette of the girls and even the teacher that already is at school.
It was like a labyrinth that you could follow. Yeah.
But then if you let the point I think you are making, and I want to stress this, is when you read this, you cannot but smile. And you have an image that will never go away of what it is when it's when the fog freezes and you make your own labyrinth. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Of course it's not true. Come on, reader, get real.
I don't know, Frank, have you been
Come on!
Have you been
But it's okay, a superb story.
No,
I don't know. It's better than life, it's bigger than life.
You don't make things up. No.
Come on.
That's it. Don't make things up.
You should go there and then find
No, but this is a point.
Have you been there?
This is an example.
No. It's not in your book. It's not in your book.
This is an example. This is an example of that stupid reader should not get drowsy, but stay awake and realize when something is an allegory.
Are you sure?
Well, Emperor, the first sentence of the Emperor. It's about the dog, the little dog called Japanese dog, Haile Selassie's dog, Lulu.
Yeah, and the peeing.
And
it pees on the
shoes of the dignitaries.
Yeah.
Right? If you're really skeptical, critical, you could close the book and say, well, I don't think this is true.
But dogs have to pee, Frank.
That's right. I buy it completely. When Kapuscinski's writing that Haile Selassie was illiterate, and you uncover that he actually read books and he was well educated, then I think that's an unforgivable mistake. He was wrong, and it's ugly. It's stupid.
Even if it's fiction.
Well, if it's fiction.
No, that's another discussion.
But then why call him Haile Selassie? Why not call him?
I think that there is a danger, and I think that to some extent, John Ryle is right, but in some other part of criticism about Kapuscinski, when you are very neglect about the details, especially when it comes to describing another culture, you can commit a sin of, as Edward Said called, Orientalism. I mean that the other culture.
Yeah.
I think there is something that Kapuscinski, who had very clear anti-colonial political stance and attitude, one of his critics, Ryle, said that he practices kind of cultural colonialism. I mean, but I think, this is maybe in this part it's not perfect, but of course it is not the scene or a mistake that disqualifies his work. But to this issue we discussed before about what is really like to be called in Russia, there is an anecdote with Kapuscinski that happened at the school or foundation of Garcia Marquez. This is Kapuscinski.
Yeah, he was also a
fraud. Kapuscinski was conducting
as a journalist
a workshop for a journal for 15 Latin American journalists, more or less of our generation. So they were already somehow accomplished, but there was a generational gap between them and Kapuscinski and Marquez. And Garcia Marquez introduced a very provocative question. Is it allowed for a journalist to paint in a tear on the face of an old woman that she didn't shed in order to express better her sadness? And he asked this question to the audience, to the journalists. And all of them, they started to protest. Absolutely, it is not allowed to do that.
Kapuscinski said yes.
No, Kapuscinski was smiling.
No.
Kapuscinski was smiling and Garcia Marquez said, I don't want to quote from the memory, he said something like that. You tell lies sometimes too, don't you, Richard? And Kapuscinski laughs. He doesn't utter a single word. The workshop participants can't tell perfectly what the answer is.
But sometimes he was making up stories about his father, for instance. Why did he do that?
But this is not in his books. To some extent, it's in Imperium, but there is no such amount of details.
Maybe you should tell the audience what story he made up.
The story is that Kapuscinski told about his father in his late years. It's that his father escaped from the train that took the hundreds of Polish soldiers and officials. It was in the beginning of the Second World War.
That he escaped.
To the Soviet camp, and then all those soldiers and officials were assassinated. There were around 15,000 Polish officers assassinated in 1940. And Kapuscinski wrote in the Empire some phrases that suggested that. He didn't express it exactly as he expressed it later in some interviews. He said that his father escaped from that. And over my investigation, I discovered that the things were different. And I came with some hypothesis about why he did that. And it was it's important to know that this assassination of Polish officials is like something signed in Polish culture and in
Katyn.
Yes. Yeah. It is this word is like signed
like
place. It's something like that.
It's very sensitive.
So when Kapuscinski was in certain moment scared because of witch hunt organized by right wing journalists, columnists, politicians, he said this because it is much, even though he still was not saved from this accusation of being red journalist, it is much more difficult to throw a stone towards someone who had in his family history cutting. I mean, so I think, but this is hypothesis. I also talked to someone who is specialist in psychoanalysis, and I get some other explanations. But I think that the most important and most probable is that one.
Arthur, may I ask you a question? Because I think you have done a courageous job, and also balancing act for yourself to write about somebody who's next popular to the Polish Pope. I think. That's that level.
Is he right?
Yeah, to some extent. It's their personality.
It's the Pope and then Kapuscinski. Yeah.
We can metaphorically say it like that.
But now you have chosen a title, the Dutch and the original Polish version, Kapuscinski Nonfiction.
Nonfiction.
I think you have diminished the scope of your book and the person by choosing this polemic title, which I can understand for reasons of choosing a polemic title. It's interesting. But
why do you use the word diminished?
Because if you read about how Kapuscinski had to operate in a communist regime, there is so much more for us from the West to understand about the minefield, not the minefield you had to go through, but Kapuscinski, if he wanted to get published, if he wanted to be a correspondent for the Polish press agency, well, he was a communist. Most of his life is about balancing
Exactly.
between walking, all these
walking the line.
Walking the line, And this is a part that is not covered by the title, which is not the only problem. But I would object, I think, being labeled by something what I'm not. That's the problem I have with non-fiction. Mm-hmm. It says only what you haven't done. It's non-fiction. So, okay, what did you do in life? Or what is you writing about? So I have trouble with the yardstick as well. So there is a yardstick implicitly in saying, well, I'm going to judge Kapuscinski, the title implies, by what he made up and what not, what's true. That's only a small part of Kapuscinski. It's relevant, it's polemic, it's interesting. We talk about it today. But first of all, I would abolish non-fiction. I don't want to be labeled as a non-fiction writer. But it only says what I'm not.
The question is he right or not?
I think he's not right.
No.
especially that
the English edition is a life.
A life,
which is better.
Yes, I was explained by... I get some explanation from British publisher, and I was happy to give this title a life. No problem. But this nonfiction was... I mean, I think that it's much better than... I think it doesn't reduce Kapuscinski to this polemic border between fiction and nonfiction. Maybe it sounds, because it's in English, but in Polish context, it sounds rather as Kapuscinski true story or something like that. But this, but at the same time, to say Kapuscinski true story would sound like banal.
It's not a nice epithet.
Yeah. And I have to tell you that after this book, and this is that I think that I'm right, at least in Poland, maybe in Netherlands it sounds strange. But this nonfiction later became somehow very famous and was used by many authors and editors in the press. For example, there is some story about something, and sometimes they put the title, this something, nonfiction. So it means how it really was. This is how it became translated in Poland. And I think that all polemics that were around the book, they were not about the title. Nobody even mentioned that. So maybe it is something about...
It's something
about
personal.
No, but not personal. Maybe about the Dutch context. Maybe in the Netherlands it doesn't sound as good as in Polish. In Poland.
No. I don't think so. The connotation, the context that you give, I think the same is true in Holland for nonfiction. It's completely. I think Kapuscinski is doing something completely different. His work.
But it's about life. It's not about only about work.
No, it's not. Even more so. So his life is so much broader than writing non-fiction.
So if you
compare the art of what he is doing, I personally like to compare it to documentary making on paper, written. If people ask me, what are you doing? I say, I make documentaries on paper. You can compare how documentaries relate to movies. So does nonfiction relate to novels? But a documentary maker, it's all about... you use real images. Okay, when he doesn't, you have a point, it's interesting, we talk about it, I agree. He shouldn't have made Haile Selassie an illiterate when he read books. But you read, you use real images. But then, it's about how you use the light. If you highlight something, it shines differently. If you, it's all about timing. Yeah. It's the way you tell the story, like your documentaries. It is everything has to do with timing, with construction of the story, and also the rhythm, the suggestion. I can make another comparison. You collect raw diamonds. Raw diamonds are not very nice. They look like stones, dirty ones. Mm-hmm. That's what you do during field work. That's what he does in Africa or in Latin America. And then when you start writing or making your documentary on paper, you make another journey. Mm-hmm. You make a journey that is going through your material. You take distance in time, distance physically, and you compose a story. And it's the narrative that you use, and I think in the case of Kapuscinski, it's essay by reportage. Mm-hmm. So now you polish your diamonds, rearrange the order, and you make them shine, and as a reader you can even use them as a mirror and see yourself. That's completely something. That's the art what Kapuscinski was doing. But it's completely different than stupid journalism.
I agree in everything you said, but except for the how does it relate to the title? I mean,
okay, but let's forget.
I think it's limited. Okay, the title is limited. Okay.
We have one more minute.
One more thing is that.
Sorry, five or.
Okay, and some questions from the public. This is important. One more thing I wanted to say, that this guy was writing for a Polish audience before he knew that he got totally famous
in the beginning,
because that was only later on. You know, he suffered for like 30 years as a correspondent. He was writing for this Polish audience. How interested were these Polish people in developments in Africa? I mean, in a way, he was a writer. Africa was some sort of excuse. And who was really interested being in Poland in those days in what happened in Africa?
Oh, I think
it was interesting in a way because they were
a lot of people. Because
yeah, because it was one of the anti-imperialism interesting developments. But I think in a way it was an excuse for him to go to these totally weird places to have this great inspiration to find material and make literature out of that. Not as a correspondent, but later on.
I don't think so. It came much later. I think that
no, but I think he had it in his head already.
No. I think that the way he...
Last words.
Yeah. The way...
Famous last words.
The reason why he started to travel around the world when he was not famous... He was a young revolutionary who was disappointed by what happened in Poland, especially in the period of Stalinism in the 1950s. So when the revolution has become institutionalized, lost its romanticism, Kapuscinski was searching the pure romantic revolution in the world, and as a journalist. But his talent...
Last words.
I read your book. So he was a poet as well. He was looking for inspiration.
No,
it was not only political.
In 1950s, he was a very lousy poet.
He wrote
about Stalin. I mean, so
yeah, I know,
his beautiful things came much later in his life.
Yeah,
so that was not this is the story. It is not that he was from the beginning was a great writer. He became over the experience. He discovered himself during those travels, but he didn't start these travels in order I will find a great material for my wonderful books in the future. It was not like that.
But he's still saying to me,
no. Okay, thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. And Ja, we hadden nog vragen kunnen stellen ook, maar we moeten echt stoppen nu.
Dat kan allemaal in de bar.
Dat kan namelijk, want de boeken gaan gesigneerd worden in de foyer. En dan kunt u ook gewoon nog vragen stellen. Dus nogmaals, dank u.
Thank you so much.